My presentation will be extremely short. I was given 10 minutes, and you know what I was meant to speak about was emerging patterns, trends, and understanding of terrorism, counterterrorism, countering violence, extremism at the national level. As you would imagine, it's mouthful, right? But I'll try and make it easier for us to move through. Just with respect to the trends, I mean, one of the things that you would see not just at the national level, but even internationally, is how terrorism is slowly but surely being bureaucratized and also decentralized, if you will, franchised. One of the most remarkable, probably, discussion that took place was when Ayman al-Zawahiri, who took over from Osama bin Laden, wrote a letter to Abubakar al-Baghdadi telling him, you know, stop what you are doing in Syria. And you would think, if you read that document, you would not think it's a conversation, you know, between two leaders of terrorist organizations, but really a conversation between a CEO of one company and a CEO of another company. A few years ago, Al-Qaeda in Maghreb, their offices were raided. And if you read some of the content, these guys were so organized. They knew what amount of food was being eaten, who was going where, the communication, to the last bit. So a lot of the time when we look at terrorists and terrorism, we look at a group of fanatics who live in, you know, stone old age, in some caves. But they are catching up with the technology, they are catching up with reality.
We used the Americans, I think, ahead of us. For a long time they realized, because of the technology that they were using to refer the terrorists, they ended up glorifying and winning sympathy for the terrorists. Because the moment they start calling them jihadist, Islamist, Wahhabist, Salafist, actually in any forum where they refer to them as that, I stand up and tell them, you don't have to go far. Here I am. I am a Wahhabi. I am a Salafi. I am an Islamist. So have you seen any change? Because for me, I would really want us to think about terminology. It's had a lot of effect on it. We might end up glorifying terrorism and win sympathy like that. And then, have you seen any change in the trend, the relationship between state players and non-state players? Take this typical example. In Isli, I'm sitting with the youth, and I ask them, if you're told that you go through this street, you'll meet police. You go through this one, you'll meet criminals. Who would you rather meet? And without thinking, they tell you, I would rather meet the criminals.
Sure. The trust between state and state agencies and the community. I think particularly, you know, the arc of terrorism, whether, you know, you start from Isli, Majengo, the southern part and the northern part. There are also historical issues to it. You know, little wonder, you know, the coastal part of Kenya wanted to secede through Mombasa Republican Council. The northern Kenya also wanted to secede. And so terrorism is layered on this fairly rich history of violations. And the way the security agencies at the beginning, you know, 8TPU, and increasingly now you have the military, you know, KWS, you even have, you know, the reservists who are involved in this. This has destroyed any kind of trust between the community. It's so eroded that, you know, in most of my work, you go and sit with people after you're done with your interviews, you ask, do you think if you know that there will be a violent crime that will be committed, would you go and report to the police? They'll tell you, most of them, no. And you say, why? They say, because the police are not very good at collecting, doing their investigation work. What they will do is you become immediately the first witness. You've got other things to do, now you're locked into this. And what that does, because of the gap, trust gap between the government and the state, within your community, people start looking at you differently. You're selling out your community. And so people are like, you know what, I don't know how to deal with this hustle.
If someone violates the law of the land, and you are not able to arrest them, you know there's a way you can arrest someone. There's a way you cannot arrest someone, particularly if they are protected by the mother. And then they are, you know, that there's a network. And somehow the intelligence finds this is the person, but you can't arrest him. There's no law that allows you to. Why not exterminate them? I'm just trying to look at it. Is the nation not supposed to protect her own citizens? So in terms of citizenship, as in this person violated his own rights, so he has no rights.
Mchungaji, do we have evidence that countries where they kill people, crime rates are lower?
Now, I wouldn't understand that's
what
I was asking.
What I'm probing is that there is no direct correlation between killing or eliminating these people and crime. I'll give an example. The United States has a death penalty in its books. Many countries in Scandinavia do not actually have death penalty on their books. If you look at crime statistics between those countries, right there is a complete difference. Of course, we are comparing apples and oranges, and also the size of the country matters. Because the reason as to what I'm saying we need to be very careful with that is, every time we have a new or contemporary security reality, our instinct, and of course it's human, you know, you feel like, you know, why bother with the long process? Let's deal with this thing here and now. We did that with Mungiki. Mungiki is still here in some parts of this country, and the stock theft, we've given shoot to kill order. Cattle rustling has not been reduced in this country. We did it with carjacking, it's not reduced. We did it with terrorism, it has not reduced. I think while I understand the instincts, when some of these things hot up, we need to get extreme measures. There is a real for pause and say why don't things work? A lot of the time people blame it on the judiciary. The judiciary cannot do the job of the police.
I spoke about the judiciary and the police, they also need that training. Because I've been monitoring all these cases, and whenever I see the police coming in with evidence and how the defense lawyers defend their suspect, you feel very embarrassed. Maybe it's a way of how you are well known with your evidence, how you bring it, especially in cyber crimes, with the cyber terror which is going on. You don't have, you have the laws, but you are not aware. And in fact, they come with their investigations, not to prove. Just one question, your case is finished. One question from the defense lawyer, your case is done. So it's a very difficult context. We cannot blame one another. It's a lot of training and a lot of integration which is needed.
My name is Adla Abubakar. I would like to talk about the, it's more of a comment, about the women's role in VE. Based on some studies that we've been doing, women get involved into VE in two ways. There are some who do it maybe willingly and knowingly, but there are some who fall victims of circumstances. Like we've had cases of women taken from Malindi to go and work as house girls in Lamu, and somehow they end up in Somalia or in Boni Forest. And we've had such women, as she talked about the returnees, some of them got some help and they came back, and they are mentally disturbed because of what they went through. They were not really fighting there, but they were to cook, and they used to be gang raped and blindfolded. So they really underwent a lot of stress, so they're mentally disturbed. So as she says, maybe there should be some work that should be initiated around dealing with the female returnees, because the kind of suffering they go through is quite different from the male returnee. Yeah, and then another thing about the supporting role that women should they should be involved in, I don't think now, like in courts especially, they're doing that much. Because I happened to work shortly with some women victims of VE whose kids and husbands have either killed or disappeared. And these women, we were trying to form them into a support group.
Women as victims, as she highlighted, on support systems. I'm not sure about how well it is in Kenya, but I can give examples from Sri Lanka, which I've been working on. I've been working with widows. Now that is very tricky because these widows are made from the Tamil, you know, traders, you know, we call it, now they have been rehabilitated. So we try to bridge the Sinhalese communities and the Tamil communities using widows. Because both are in the having their grievances. So they come for a common basis of a loss. Now they come discuss. So now they don't have anger on each other. Maybe in the future we can think on that end of support communities.
Mine is just more of a comment. One of the things that I wanted to emphasize was the case of women extremists have become challenging to creating a female profile, especially when we know that there's no significant gendered pathway to radicalization. So what the research is much needed on that aspect of creating that female profile, because it's highly gendered. You talked about the process of radicalization being, it is gendered, but the push and pull factors are generally similar. But I would say that it is similar, but there's also that gender aspect. If you see it as a male recruitment, can also feel like they wouldn't want to join because they're not fulfilling their gender roles as men, as husbands, as opportunities out there. But also we have this aspect about women, or young women actually, that are specific. When we talk about women, there is specific that we, the gap of age that we're supposed to focus at young women, at what a specific age that we they are being recruited. Because with this lack of empowerment of these women, they're the ones who are being recruited. But yet again, we also have this challenging research, as also from Women International Security, is that these women are, that are joining also are aware of agencies. There are no people who are under, that lack social economic opportunities, but they are, they have agencies and opportunities, but they're to join. So one of the things that scored that was much problem that brings is the female profile that should be created to understand deeply about the push and pull factors in the gender aspect for both men and women.
Important, I hope I have addressed men, and also the aspect of having a particular profile, gender profile, which is very important. I tried my best, which is not easy because profiles are very differing, as I said, from my interviews, which is very, may not be many, but from a limited aspect, I found many fall on the high income, not high, at least middle income high. So I couldn't find many on the poverty level. So I can't get into one profile that says women of poverty or women of this level or women profile who are like, but one aspect I can clearly point out is women who get into this are really dominant in their communities, especially the recruiters. They are well linked. They know everything. So there is a level of a particular how well they integrate with the community. So they become very good recruiters. So I don't have one profile on how I can bring this aspect of women. But and also push and pull factor, she's correct. It differs from men and women. That's why I got this example of hijra, how a man will see, how a woman will see. Even the word jihad, how they will categorize. It's very well linked on these ideologies. How, you know, these entrepreneurs also, the radical or the extremist entrepreneurs, they know who needs what, where, how. For a mother, it would be on a son perspective, or a, you know, they know how to very well frame the issue. You don't have one message coming for everyone. They know how to frame it very well based on their particular target groups. So you're correct, push and pull factors differ from men and women.
The misconceptions that they have created, the terminology that they have claimed and taken monopoly of, we need to reclaim it and then explain to the people. Then, after that, we need to develop appropriate counter-narratives. Equally, they have to be religious also. So these are religious narratives, understand them fully, then develop appropriate religious counter-narratives from the same sources. It has to be, if they're going to use a verse from the Quran, I have to use a counter-narrative from the Quran. If they're going to use a hadith from the Prophet ﷺ, the counter must also be from the Prophet ﷺ or even stronger. And then also explain some of this terminology that Al-Shabaab has claimed to be theirs, like the word Shaheed. Let me try and scare you a little bit now here. The people who are not Muslims here, when you hear a group of Muslims somewhere shouting, Takbir, Allahu Akbar, what comes into your mind? War, ready for death. I'm a civilian. Yeah, you feel now somebody is going to die here. Okay, what about when you hear Christians say, Praise the Lord? What do you feel? It's very peaceful. Do you know the meaning of Takbir, Allahu Akbar? It means praise Allah. Allahu Akbar. Allah is the greatest. What is terror? What is terrorizing about those words? But it's because of the way they have been used. So we say somebody has to come up and reclaim these terminologies and use them. And that's why Abdullah said here, on our some of our TV commentaries, we brought Jamila Muhammad, a Muslim in her hijab, to say, I am Jamila Muhammad. My jihad is to inform the people. And we were very careful here. We did not say, jihad is informing people. My jihad. And that's why I tell Nelson Marwa, his jihad is to ensure the coast province is safe. This lady who is cooking viazi vya madonge, say, my jihad is to feed my family. And I say, as Ibrahim Letome, my jihad is to inform people of the true Islam.
ISIS is in Kenya, is present in Kenya. I don't know whether you have come across these kind of questions and the kind of evidence as people working in the field that you may have. And finally, in terms of interaction, you know, between the work and the actors involved, particularly in rehabilitation, which is quite sensitive, that you do it bravely, you know, the government aspect of rehabilitation that was lightly talked about, how has that progressed, or is it now completely dead? Finally, the question of politics, particularly now, that is generating a fertile environment. I don't know whether you have come across these kind of questions and the kind of evidence as people working in the field that you may have. And finally, in terms of interaction, you know, between the work and the actors involved, particularly in rehabilitation, which is quite sensitive.
Syria, Al-Shabaab might have their base in Ras Kamboni, Boko Haram in wherever in Nigeria, but do they have sympathizers here? Do they have people here who believe in their ideology and are ready to do anything to perpetrate that ideology? The answer is yes. And I'll give you this very painful example for me. When the two mosques were closed in Mombasa, Masjid Musa and Masjid Sakina, it coincided also between the closure and the eventual opening of the mosque. And Mashinia will tell you the efforts that went through the negotiations with government, looking at the pros and cons of having, leaving those mosques closed. It happened that the teachers were killed in Mandela. Let me tell you, within the streets, you would hear some people saying, you see, because the teachers have been killed, the mosques have been open. So anytime they close the mosques, we slaughter a few and the mosques will be open. Little did they know that we were negotiating. There was a lot of negotiations going on. What does that tell you? They have sympathizers all over. These people are with us here. And the title of their magazine, Gaidi Mtaani, it's very deliberate that don't look for us out there. We are here with you. The example that I gave you of the case study of Garissa. The imam was in Garissa. Before he could leave the mosque, he received a call. And he was told, we have heard you. Meaning, Al-Shabaab might be sitting in Ras Kamboni, but it has its ears and eyes in the mosque. And I believe even in Jamia Mosque, in every mosque, they could be having their presence there. So we can no longer look at it as something that is outside there. It's home. We have now homegrown terrorism, which we have to deal with. Then, where is bread? Very quickly. I know that is a question that we have been hearing, because we were very visible in the media, and again, also physically, we were coming. We were a little bit restrained, and also we had to go back to the drawing table. We are coming back next month. Now we have our manual ready, and we are rolling out. We are rolling out very soon again.
I want to say that I was told it's a new program, new research into this field. And as I said, I really support research. I would say that would be that project is formally, should I say, formally launched.